What I'm going to do is tell you just a little bit about acrylic pour painting. This video isn't about that necessarily. I just wanted to see, I'm testing equipment, but acrylic pour painting is something that I discovered by accident while I was on the phone with someone and I was trying to find a way to multitask, meaning I didn't really want to talk on the phone. So I was watching YouTube videos at the same time, but that's neither here nor there. I discovered something on one of those videos that I was streaming where people were just pouring paints and making these beautiful abstracts. Now I must confess that I like to paint myself, and so I'm a brush artist, but I saw it as something that was therapeutic and the results are beautiful and mysterious. So I was a little intrigued, needless to say. And I went on a hunt and I bought canvases and I bought acrylic paint and I bought some stuff called Floetrol. And I've been watching videos on mixing. And one of the types of pour painting, one of the expressions is called Dutch pour, which I think is what is going to inspire this video, because I have in my head a way to incorporate the Dutch pour technique with my brush technique. So if I get the airbrush brush to work the way that I think and hope it will, I'll be onto something, perhaps creating a little bit of my own self in it, which is always something that I do. I learn from someone else and then I have to make it my own, which I think is the mark of the creative process. Of course, we are inspired by others' creativity, but then we want to do something that expresses who we are. So what I have here is a failure. I didn't like the underpainting, and so I started pouring additional paint on top of the underpainting, and it created a very thick layer of paint, and as a result of that, the paint cracked. I don't know if you can see it, but the paint cracked throughout the drying process, because of course the moisture was underneath, and so some of it was drying at different speeds, and I ended up with a wreck. So I am going to use this canvas just as a test canvas. I don't think it's salvageable unless there's some kind of way to fill in cracks on painting, and they're so cheap, so why should I? But one of the things that I like to do is look at the back of this. These are little thumbtacks. They have some huge ones on Amazon. I'm just using some ones that we picked up from Walmart. But what you do is you attach the thumbtacks to the back of the canvas. This is a stretched canvas with a wooden frame. There are canvas panels out there, and I've tried to use a canvas panel, but that's made of cardboard. And because there's so much water or moisture in the pouring mediums, the cardboard will warp. This right here is nothing but fabric underneath, and no paper or anything like that. So the air dry, the airflow will cure the paint, of course, as long as you don't have such a thick layer. But I don't think that the acrylic canvas boards work as well for acrylic painting, unless you're doing something where you're blowing, where you're moving paint around, but you don't flood it with as much Floetrol or water or glue or whatever you're using. So I'm going to nail in some thumbtacks. And you put them in the corners. Try not to go down there. They're joined, of course, at the corners. So try not to nail into the joins of the wooden frame. And so you get them down in there. And I have a leveler just to see if I'm somewhat level. This is a bit much for what I'm trying to do, but old habits die at heart. So yes, it's level. And what I also found to be helpful for my smaller paintings, which I'm right now, because I'm still experimenting a lot, I do a lot of 8x10 canvases, but this right here is a simple Lazy Susan. And what you can do with a Lazy Susan is when you're painting and you want to get to a corner, but you don't want to keep picking up your canvases, you can put it on a Lazy Susan and just rotate it. So I have enjoyed this, but for the larger canvases, I think I'm going to be on my own. And I usually protect my surface with wax paper, I find that that's just as easy. There are lots of people who say something about a silicone mat, but when I look at their later videos, it appears that they've gone back to something simpler like a wax paper or a freezer paper or something. But anyway, this is white paint, just white paint. I'm not trying to be perfect. I'm not trying to do it the way I would do it if I were actually trying to succeed at creating a Dutch pour. But what you do to get a flow of your paint is you flood it with white paint first, because the white paint will allow the other paints to flow. So I should have put on gloves. I have some behind me. But anyway, I have my gloves on. I'm just going to do this the barbaric way and spread it out with my fingers. Again, I'm not trying to be perfect. I'm just trying to get some results with my paintbrush. I'm using some pretty bright colors today just because I feel bright. I have some yellow, just regular old yellow. And this is a beautiful color blue. I don't want to use up too much of it because my blues are my favorite color. One technique that I found out is that if you want whatever color you want to show up in your pour painting, at least for the Dutch pour, you put it on the top. So I'm going to start off with yellow. I'm going to do this side with yellow, and I'm going to do this side with yellow, because I'm going to do one side with the airbrush, and then I'm going to do the other side with the hair dryer. I'm going to eventually show you how to mix paints, or I'll point you to a video where the person's already done the work for me. But you just layer these on top, and I'm going to come back in with a little bit of pink, and a little bit of pink coming in there, and a little bit of pink coming in there. So I'm going to put a little bit of white here, and I'm going to put a little bit of white here. Here we go. I'm doing the dryer first because I know what the dryer is going to do. All right, so my dryer. I'm going to blow over it. And then I'm going to come back this way. I'm going to go back that way. I'm going to come back that way. And it doesn't look like anything. Let's see if I can get a little bit more. So that just is for the blowing of a dryer. I got a little bit better action over on this side. What I'm going to do now is switch out from the dryer and pray that I get some kind of movement with the airbrush. So here is a little bit of paint. I'm going to utilize the benefits of this Lazy Susan and rotate. I am going to pick up the, all right, pulling this, I got something. Okay, so it did move the paint that direction. And let's see if I take it this way. I'm gonna rotate it and I'm gonna blow it back. I'm excited. Yeah. Okay. And let's see if I blow this with it. But let's see. I'm going to turn it this way. I'm getting what I wanted out of this airbrush because I want it to be able to control smaller sizes. Ooh, yay. All right. And let's go over here and just make it into something. We can decide. I am excited. I'm not saying that this is the best looking painting because it's not supposed to be, but the airbrush gives me enough blowing power to manipulate this very runny paint. And so if my next part of my theory works, then I can do some brush work and create something unique for me. But I'm quite thrilled with this. Good purchase, Maria. Woo! All right, I will see you later. And thank you for watching if you made it this far.